this is Kelly Mara here. I'm back again with another redesign video. If you're new to the channel, I'm currently doing a series where I try to suggest better stories and characters for Yandere Simulator, and I've got a bit of storyline going on, so if you want the full context, go check out my previous videos. I've got a handy playlist that will be linked in the description for that and at the end of the video as well, so you don't have to worry. Basically, this is pretty much my petty way of saying, yeah, I can do better if I wanted to Yandere Dev, and if you disagree with me, you're wrong, but you can still talk about it in the comments below. Today, I am doing my twist on Kizana Sunobu and channeling that confident aura, if you couldn't tell. If you saw the thumbnail of this video, you might be thinking, why are there two characters instead of one? Well, I suggest you stick around because these videos, if you've been following the series, are hardly just design videos. I actually rewrite the character and their backstory completely and basically make them an entirely different person. And speaking of making them entirely different characters, I mentioned in my last video before I went on my clinical placement, it went great by the way, I was in perioperative and I got to see C-sections and babies being born. I wanted to give my versions their own names to separate them from Yandere Dev's creations. Yeah. So, name reveal! To recap, my version of Ayano Aishi and our Yandere girl is named Himari Sato. So, first name Himari, last name Sato. It would be Sato Himari if we're going with Japanese naming conventions. Senpai is now named Seiya Takahashi, Takahashi being his surname, and he is also the leader of the martial arts club and surrogate parent to his little sister. For my version of Osananajimi, whose name literally means childhood friend, the typical tsundere character, I made her a gamer girl who streams on Twitch, who is spiteful to Senpai because he essentially shut her out after he assumed the role of a parent to his little sister, and he doesn't want her to know what's happening in his home life. I've decided her new name will be Reika Nakamura, with Nakamura being her surname. It means fresh flower or lovely petal, and to me, it just sounds like a fiery name that matches her personality, and all her friends get to call her Rei-chan, and I like that a lot. For Amai Odayaka, who is, I guess, the sweet girl next door type, I didn't change much about her personality because I already liked it. I just altered her design somewhat and gave her a bit of a chubbier figure to help her stand out more compared to the other girls. Plus, it makes her look really approachable and soft, which really complements her personality. Her new name is Mayumi Watanabe, with Watanabe of course being her surname, and Mayumi means gentle and true, which is perfect for my new concept, and I also like the nickname Yumi-chan for her, because it kinda sounds like yummy, which of course fits her baker aesthetic. Stick around to the end to hear Kizana's new name. But before we get to the video, I just want to briefly talk about this new drawing tablet I was sent by Gaomon, which I'm using to make this redesign. They reached out to me and asked if I would like to review one of their tablets, and I was really excited because I've never used a drawing tablet with a display before. The only other drawing tablet I've ever owned was a Wacom Bamboo tablet that I had to beg my parents for, and let's just say the tablet Gaomon sent me was leagues above that.
Hey guys, something a little bit different. We're doing an unboxing because I was sent this really cool drawing tablet by Gaomon, which is, I've never actually had an actual like professional drawing tablet before, so I'm really excited to see what's inside and how it works and figure out how to use it. So yeah, the model they sent was
the PD1560, which is 15.6 inches with 1920 by 1080p HD display, 10 shortcut keys, an arm stand, and 8,192 levels of pen pressure. As someone who was previously drawing on a Surface Pro 5, you really notice those 8,192 levels. They also sent me a matte screen protector, which feels like paper when you draw on it, a pen holder that also stores replacement nibs, a handy tablet sleeve, and a smudge guard. So you can pretty much say I was boiled rotten. The setup was super straightforward and I had no trouble getting it up and running. You just download the driver from their website according to the model you have and run it. The tablet was also super intuitive, no huge learning curves or anything like what I worried about initially. I've been using it for over a few weeks now and there are a couple of things that I feel I should mention. First of all, when the tablet first arrived, the pen that came with it wasn't working. I thought it was a driver issue at first because the pen wasn't registering at all on the tablet despite reinstalling and downloading different versions of the driver. But I emailed Gaomon and they were really cool and gave me a step-by-step to troubleshoot, and eventually we discovered that the pen batteries were flat. Like, no matter how long I charged it, as soon as it was unplugged, it was just dead. So they were like, sorry about that, we'll send you a new one. So I had to wait for that pen to arrive, but when it did, all was well. The next thing I noticed was that the accuracy of the screen cursor relative to the actual location of the pen tip on the display itself can be really off sometimes, especially at a tilt, which makes it really annoying when you want to do precise line art and you don't like holding the pen straight on. But I managed to fix this by just changing the zoom percentage on my display settings. One final annoying thing was that if you set a shortcut button as a command series with control in it, it sticks sometimes. Like, I would click the button I programmed with Control Z to undo, but then my laptop thinks I'm still holding down the control button, so when I try to navigate, it ends up zooming in or out really fast, which you might notice in my speed draws recently. And to fix that, I had to press the actual control button on my laptop keyboard every time it happened, which was really inconvenient. Another thing is that you can't register the space key. Technically you can, but it doesn't actually work on CSP for some reason, and that's really such a shame because I do need the space key to navigate across the canvas because I can't move the screen with my fingers. It's annoying, but it hasn't really hindered me much because I still end up typing commands in my laptop anyway while I draw. I can't say how it compares to a Cintiq because I've never used a Cintiq before, but the closest comparator I could find was this one, which is way more expensive and comes with a lot less for what you get with this tablet's bundle. I'd say if you're looking to upgrade and don't want to break the bank, this tablet will go a long way. They've also got a promo right now for $40 off if you use the link in my description for a limited time only. So if you're looking for a new drawing tablet, this is your chance. Let's see it in action and get on with the video, shall we? So, for this redesign, we're looking at a theater kid. The original concept says that she is arrogant and egoistical, as if her surname isn't already Snob. And I guess this is also a play on the Himedere archetype. No, this character is the Himedere archetype, because that's all she is. Nothing more, nothing less. Himederes are characters that, by definition, want to be treated like royalty by the person they love, but the characters that fall into this archetype generally also have an awful superiority complex. Usually, they are very wealthy or have an important social standing, which definitely feeds into their egos. I'm generally not a fan of this archetype for similar reasons on why I'm not a fan of tsunderes. However, I can see why people might be into himederes because they're regal, eloquent, well-mannered, and cultured, and rich, which is the most important thing for me. But the whole ego thing is what gets me. The only time I feel that that ego is justified is if it's backed up by some sort of skill that's worthy of reverence. For example, Erina Nakiri from Food Wars. She's really good at cooking and she has this God-given gift to smell and taste things that other people can't. Which, yeah, in an anime all about tasting and eating food, that would be something to revere. But when they're only good at being rich, that's when I find it a bit pathetic. So in this case, Kizana is already off to a good start. Her profile says that she has the ability to captivate an audience and she's very beautiful. So I assume that means that she's good at acting, which is great because that's literally all her character is. She wants to be a famous actor and the most popular girl in school and... yeah, seems a bit bare bones, but for a game like Yandere Simulator that is just anime stereotypes, the game, it works. But my content is all about character-driven stories, so let's make something a bit more interesting. We are going to create a character based off of the Himedere trope while elevating Kizana's visual design. Then, we're going to give her a more detailed personality, a backstory that ties in more strongly with her theme, and we're gonna talk about where she falls into the storyline. I also have an OC with an actress theater concept, so I will be integrating her into this concept to make her feel more like a character I would make and roleplay with. So, yeah, if you notice some similarities to my comic, wink wink. Alright, first order of business, the design. Those twin tails have got to go. Now, I don't have a problem with twin tails, but for some reason, Yandere Dev uses it a lot, including for three of the rivals and magical girl Pretty Miyuki. Now, I don't know if it's because he's just not that creative and he doesn't know a lot about hairstyling and is too lazy to look at alternatives, or if he just has a thing for them and it turns him on. And it's probably everything, all of the above, to be honest, and that's exactly why it has to go. Plus, the drills on Kokona was a lot nicer than the one he ended up giving Kizana because, let's be honest, Kizana's hair looks like purple poop. Or a croissant. Or croissant, however you want to pronounce it. We were all thinking it. Don't act like I was the only one. Please. So, I still decided to keep the hair curls, but I wanted to commit to it even more. And to take it a step further, I made it so that her entire hair is curled. This is a hairstyle I've never actually done before and something I was experimenting with at first, but I was really happy with how it came out and I ended up having a lot of fun with it. Kizana's theme was roses, so I wanted to incorporate that into the design as much as I could, and her hair ended up being a really good call because the silhouette looked like rose petals. I also gave her straight fringes because I think they look amazing and I feel like that's kind of what all of the Hime characters have in anime. And it's just, I don't know. I think women who go for straight fringes are so cool because not everyone can pull them off and it takes a lot of confidence to rock them. I also find them really difficult to draw, so I wanted to challenge myself. For her uniform, I gave her the first year uniform because it would match her aesthetics best, and so that this character will be in the same year as Himari and Reika. That does mean she isn't quite the leader of the drama club yet, but she's definitely a rising star. You can see already how different my line art looks in this redraw, and it's definitely because of the tablet I'm using. Normally, I can't achieve this level of pressure on my laptop, so that was really cool. I decided to keep the same hair color because purple is known to be a regal color and it's sort of associated with royalty, but I changed her eyes to be more of a lilac blue just to break it up a little. The main customizers on her wardrobe are her tie and stockings. For her necktie, instead of wearing it in a ribbon, she ties it in this really cool knot called a rosebud knot, which would align with her theme, and it's just one of my favorite tie knots in general. There are surprisingly a lot of ways you can knot ties. For her stockings, I decided to give her pantyhose because it makes her seem more mature and refined. And I also feel like it's such a rich kid thing to do as well, to wear pantyhose as part of their uniform when you don't have to. I don't know. I feel like maybe that's just me. It just looks really classical, and I think it falls into the rose/theater aesthetic. Yandev definitely tried with the rose print on her original stockings, but it just feels really tacky to me. I don't know, sometimes less is more. I feel like my art style is coming through a lot more on this redesign, and I'm super pleased with that. It also definitely helps that I have a wider canvas to work with compared to my laptop, which is really puny in comparison. So aside from some accuracy issues where I'm trying to line and it's just not lining up, I'm pretty happy with it so far. Now, you're probably wondering what the deal is with the second character, and my answer to that is, they're not twins. They are, in fact, the same person. As I've said, I'm really going into the theater and acting concept, so I thought it would be fitting to create a character who has to play a role in their daily life. Kind of like a Hannah Montana situation, which would mean that she would also be the character who would relate to Himari the most. But that's something to talk about in her backstory. For now, let's talk about her personality. For this character, I took a lot of inspiration and theming from these masks, which is pretty much symbolic of theater. The ability to play different roles and convey different emotions as other people. Yeah. These masks are also the reason why I drew two versions of this character, because she is always split up into different personas, playing different roles, and the first depiction is her stage persona. With her hair and makeup completely done up, dazzling and captivating, standing with confidence and self-assurance. This is the persona she uses when she's at school. She is incredibly beautiful and multi-talented. She's excellent at acting, singing, dancing, and she even plays piano. Her passion for theater is clear, and nobody doubts that she can become a famous actor one day. She easily rises to popularity as soon as the school year starts due to her background and excellence in her studies, and she brings in huge crowds to the drama club's performances. She's definitely a diva in that things have to be done a specific way for her to be happy with it, but it's simply because she's a perfectionist. She can be very harsh and difficult to work with when things don't go her way, but no matter what role you give her, she always manages to steal the show. However, just as she is quick to get fans and supporters, she is just as quickly making enemies from people who can't stand her diva-like behavior. However, what is known about her life outside of school is actually close to nothing. In fact, some people claim that she vanishes into thin air as soon as school ends, just like the Phantom of the Opera. And that's because as soon as the bell rings, she transforms into her second persona. Yes, The plain-looking girl who is very withdrawn and quiet is actually the person behind the mask. This persona is shy and reserved, timid and self-conscious with a lot of self-doubt. She presents herself very plainly and blends easily into the background. People would hardly look twice at her as she hides in her baggy jumper and fringes. Unlike her stage persona, she stands with her shoulders squared and her head down, tucking herself in and making herself appear small. She's a very sensitive person who likes reading romance novels, writing music, and is very humble to the point that she is self-deprecating sometimes. Now, you might be asking why she has two personas she presents herself as. And for that, let's move on to her backstory. Keeping with the Himedere trope, this character comes from a very wealthy and important family. I imagine they came from a long line of aristocrats and hold some degree of noble status in present day, with many of their family members being in politics and holding important positions in the country. But I'm putting a little twist where instead of her being the darling daughter that gets spoiled rotten, she's actually under a lot of pressure due to expectations from her family. She has to be confident, charming, well-educated, well-cultured, and overall perfect to uphold her family name. That is when her stage persona began to appear. She learned to put on a facade that would please her family and impress their many important friends, and that is the persona she must maintain at school as well. However, when her parents are away, which is pretty much all the time, and she's left with just the maids and butlers at home, she can drop the act and just be herself. She enjoys wearing loose, baggy clothing much more than tailor-made couture, and she much prefers staying in and watching movies than going out to parties. She's waiting for the day that she graduates high school so she can pursue a real acting career, and then she can be whoever she wants beyond her parents' control. So as soon as the day ends, she washes out the curls from her hair, wipes off her makeup, pulls on her comfy sweater, and walks home to enjoy a peaceful evening. Her parents are very strict on how she dresses and presents herself, so she must be very careful not to be caught being so unsightly. Normally, if she is aware that her parents will be home, she will go home with a private driver without changing out of her stage persona. However, the fact that she is only noticed as her stage persona makes her believe that if she were to be who she really was, nobody would like or care about her, just as her parents said. And that's where we get to how she fits into the narrative. She meets Senpai for the first time not as her stage persona, but as her offstage persona. She was about to walk home from school when Seiya runs into her, not having noticed her being there, and because of how much bigger he is than her, he knocks her over. He apologizes and helps her stand back up, but she tells him that he shouldn't worry about it because it happens to her all the time. Feeling bad, he offered to walk her home and carry her bags for her, and this surprises her. Why? Because nobody had ever offered to do anything for her when she wasn't dressed up and pretty. In fact, people who bumped into her wouldn't even apologize and just tell her to watch where she's going. So, she's touched by Seiya's kindness, and she agrees to walk home together. As they speak, it turns out they have a lot in common. They like the same movies and they relate to each other about family pressures and having to hide things from others. However, when he asked her what her name was, she decided not to tell him just in case he treated her differently because he knew who she really was. And so, Seiya never realizes that this girl was actually the school diva herself because he knows what it's like to have secrets, so he wasn't gonna pry. And in fact, he actually wasn't so fond of her stage persona because of how she treats people. But since that day, Seiya will always walk home with her, deepening their bond each time. Because of that, this character is a major threat to the player. Now, if you haven't watched my first video where I overhauled Ayano, I made it so that our Yan-chan Himari is actually attending school as someone else. Someone from a wealthy family who could afford to pay for Himari's tuition, books, and uniform while they went off to travel the world. Therefore, you could have an easy in with this character, as her parents would want her to mingle with students from wealthy, important families, which would include you. And so, you can cozy up with her and learn her secrets and figure out the best way to take her down. Perhaps you could convince her to start being herself at school instead of pretending to be what her parents want her to be, only to rat her out to those very parents and get her punished. Perhaps you could expose her identity to Seiya and convince him that she's only acting and trying to hurt him. The irony here is that technically Himari is doing the same thing. Or you could use the people that already dislike her and get them to do your bidding for you to run her out of the school. And of course, there's always the option to kill her. Maybe put some rat poison in a drink she's meant to have for a play, or drop a sandbag on her head. But as usual, because this game isn't just a murder game, the best solution would be to allow Himari to introspect. See, this character and Himari have the most parallels so far because they're both pretending to be someone they're not. They're both acting and playing a role to get what they want, and this character is the only person who would really be able to understand Himari in that regard. If you befriend both her personas and listen to her struggles, Himari would be able to notice a lot of similarities between this character and herself. She would learn empathy. And perhaps even be able to share her secret back, the fact that she's lying to everyone, she's not who she says she is, which of course this character interprets as her, well, a more similar to situation to her in that she's kind of pretending to be someone for the sake of someone else, but you know the case. And if you use her to vent, it would also help keep Himari's sanity intact. As you know, in my version of the game, the more murders you commit, the less effective your medication is going to be in keeping your mind stable. Just laughing it out isn't going to solve your issues. You will need to resort to more coping mechanisms to maintain your sanity and keep track of who you really are. So having friends, having hobbies, those are the kinds of things you would need to rely on more and more. So befriending this character may be an invaluable asset, helping you to improve not only your ruse, but also to avoid losing track of who you really are. So, how does befriending this character stop her from pursuing Seiya, you ask? Well, both this character and Himari are very dedicated to their goals. This character wants to pursue acting and gain freedom from her parents, and Himari simply wants Seiya. So if you were to come clean and just tell her, she will understand how important their goals are to each other and back off. Additionally, this character is a bit of a romantic herself, so she would find Himari's dedication to finding love admirable and sweet. And with that, here is the final concept. I hope you guys enjoy it as much as I did making it. The Gaomon tablet definitely did wonders for me, and if you're interested in getting one for yourself, check out the link in my description. Now, for her name, I've decided on Izumi. For her given name, Izumi is the name of a princess in Japan that I found when I brought up a list of Japanese princesses on Wikipedia, and it sounded pretty. And Hojo for her surname, because it sounds like a really serious, important name that dates back hundreds of years. Let me know what you guys thought of this video. If you have any ideas on how the story unfolds and what you would like to see next in the comments below. Don't forget to follow me on all my social media. Check out my comic because that would make me really happy. And I will see you guys in the next video. Goodbye!